Hello there again. Talk about Christmas surprises. This has been a night of huge upsets in boxing terms. Our sixth and final world title fight coming up, and it is the big one. Kevin Kelly stands in Naseem Hamed's way right now, but Naseem Hamed on the brink, he hopes, of capturing the hearts and minds of the American public. 28 straight wins for the champion, Kelly a former world champion himself. Here's Barry McGuigan on the tactics of our main event.
One of Naz's best assets is his speed and movement. He is in and out so quickly, his opponents often become frustrated and have to resort to wild lunges. The angles that he produces are unbelievable. Here he is off balance, yet lands a powerful left. We all know of Naz's power as shown against Alessia, and here we can see how he adjusts his body to get maximum power into his shots. Problems arise for Naz when he misses. He leaves his head unprotected and becomes vulnerable. By relying on his reflexes as his defense, one good punch by his opponent could end Naz's dream. Kevin Kelly is a thoughtful fighter with a sturdy defense. He waits for the right moment to unleash powerful shots. Kelly too has a knockout punch, using his legs, hips and back to maximize his power. Kelly can be caught though, having been knocked down several times, but apart from on one occasion, he's got up to win. The question tonight is who lands first with a big punch and who takes the best shot?
Thank you, Barry. Duke, do you see it as an explosive match?
I think Hamed will shine. I think in America, where he's allowed to, where he will be allowed to showboat and do the things that he loves to do, once he's, if he hits Kelly and he hurts him, he will just enjoy himself and he will just excel and do something that none of us probably could even imagine.
Nicky?
I see it being a great fight, and Naz, I think in about six rounds, could go in one, could go in six. He's the type of fighter that every fight is always exciting to look forward to because anything can happen. As Barry says, he leans off, comes in, leaves his chin wide open sometimes, but he's got tremendous power and knockout ability.
Steve, the recipe's been perfect so far for Naseem Hamed. Why should it be any different tonight?
I think Naz is going to win. I think he's going to make it look easy because he's got a style like Kelly never saw before. And although they say Naz leaves himself open, he leaves himself open when he's punching. So usually when his chin is up in the air, he usually lands, and he lands with power. And Kelly is a great fighter. He has been a great fighter, but Naz is on the way up. He's getting better. Kelly, I think, maybe on the slide, but it's going to take a really good fighter to beat Kelly, and Naz is the good fighter who will beat him.
They've both been coming out with some big shots verbally in the build-up to the fight. Huge hype surrounded it all week. They've invested millions of dollars in publicising the fight, but really they could have left it to the two fighters that got on with it all by themselves. Here's what happened at the weigh-in. Ian Dark watched it.
Neither Prince Naseem Hamed nor Kevin Kelly are exactly shy, so their final pre-fight face-to-face confrontation was always going to be a lively affair, hammed up for the cameras at a boisterous weigh-in. There was a sizable British contingent, but plenty of Americans as well, anxious to see this British star being unveiled in their city. Ex-world champion Kelly is a native New Yorker with only one defeat in 50 fights. He looks Naseem's most dangerous opponent yet and was half a pound inside the featherweight limit of 9 stone. No apparent nerves for Naseem despite the millions invested in him taking off in America. He got a big reception from the British fans and was bang on the 9 stone limit. He even led the fans in a sing-song.
We'll be singing when we win it. We'll be singing. We'll be singing. We'll be singing.
Don't get me, man.
Then backstage, another set too with Kelly.
You don't run and I won't run. We'll come out and have a war in the first round.
Bet. We got a deal.
Yeah, don't back
we got
up.
A deal.
Let's do it.
You know I'm a warrior.
Look in the eyes. Let's do it.
You know I love that.
Let's do it.
I'm a real New Yorker.
I can't wait to do it.
Wasteland
don't
warrior,
run,
baby.
Don't
I'm from the Wasteland. I know I'm not going to
run. I heard you're going to run.
Run?
Yeah.
You have misinformed, homie.
I'm talking run.
You tell your brother. He's been misinformed.
You know.
The unbeaten Naseem is very conscious of flying the flag for Britain here.
I'm from Sheffield and I'm proud to be from Sheffield, the whole of Yorks and the whole of Britain. They're now going to be bringing my belt back victorious, and that's what I always do, win. And I'm going to, and I'm pure win, I'm going to take him completely out.
Fighters are not going to win. I'm not Nostradamus, and neither is he. He's not this great legendary fighter that everybody's predicting that he's going to be, and they'll find out tomorrow night when the bell rings, when I hit him with the first punch.
Surprised they've got the energy to fight after all that, but they're about to get to it. Live from Naseem's dressing room, getting gloved up. Brendan Ingle applying the finishing touches ahead of his ninth world title defense here. Well, he's predicted a third round finish. Let's see if he's going to be as good as his word tonight. Is he going to be, Barry?
Yeah, I think, you know, ultimately, what I said at the end of my piece there was it's down to who takes the best shot. And in the McKennie-Jones fight, it worked out who had the best chin. We had doubts about Jones in the past. You know, he's shown that maybe he's slightly vulnerable. And I think this is what it boils down to. Kevin Kelly's a decent puncher, good switch hitter, and he's smart too, and he could cause problems early on. And if Naz pops his chin up in the air, he could end up on the seat of his pants like he did against Alassia. But he'd get up and knock him out, that's for sure.
Nicky, a smart fighter, dangerous fighter, Kelly?
He's a very dangerous fighter, good boxing ability with a great punch in either hand. I was looking at the changing room there with Naseem, and it didn't seem the usual Naseem changing room. No whooping and hollering and no music.
Oh, come on, he's played himself out all week.
This guy, the changing room itself there, I'm saying. I mean, maybe, but... And I know he's confident, I know he's not frightened, but it just seems like he's feeling the pressure. This is the big stage.
I saw him as over in Dublin, the National Basketball Arena, when it was a low-profile thing. Nobody knew who the hell he was. He still came out and was dynamite. So I don't think it'll be any different tonight.
Steve, you've gone through something similar to Naseem Hamed, launching yourself in America. Is it different? Will he be feeling different in the build-up to this fight compared with other nights?
Honestly, I've fighting in a ring. It's obviously the same size, and I don't think being away will affect him at all. I think if anything, he's got a point to prove, and he needs something to go for. He needs something to interest him, something to excite him. And going to America is a big step for him. It's a big opportunity, and I think he'll want to perform. So therefore, he'd probably do a better job than he would do if he was fighting him in Sheffield.
It'll be interesting if he gets hit hard in the first round and ends up being hurt or stunned. That might change the complexity of the fight and change his attitude towards the fight. However, let's wait and see. It's a fascinating encounter.
Here's the tail of the tape for our main event tonight, this WBO World Featherweight title fight then. Naseem, 23 years of age. Kevin Kelly approaching the veteran stage, just past the age of 30. Kelly with a big height advantage, 4 inches taller than Naseem, and a 3-inch reach advantage as well. But it's what Naseem does with his that counts, isn't it? 28 fights for Naseem, 28 wins. Kelly, a total of 50 fights and only one defeat all through that professional record. He is a proven world-class performer, a former world champion in his own right, and he refuses to just drift away into the twilight. He has been seriously inconvenienced by the fact Naseem has taken up the publicity this week. He feels himself to be the hometown fighter, and he wants to put the record straight in the ring. Bookmakers' odds for this one. Naseem, a huge favourite, 4-1 on. Kelly, 7-2 against. Naseem, points, they don't fancy that at 4-1. First round knockout for Naseem, 14-1. Well, it's happened before. This is the moment we've all been waiting for. Naseem has built his career around taking on the world. He has to go to America to do it. And where better than Madison Square Garden? Let's hear from Glenn McCroy and Ian Dark.
Well, there's a tremendous sense of occasion here. After all the millions of dollars spent on the launch, can Prince Naseem Hamed deliver? I agree with what Nicky Piper was saying back there in London. He just seemed a little more thoughtful than usual, not quite as boisterous in the dressing room. Or are we reading too much into things, Glenn?
Well, it did look that way, but I think, you know, we've got to remember that this is a very big fight, and I think he does fool around, he does mess about, but I think underneath there is a serious side, and I think, you know, he's got to be more thoughtful. This is a trickier fight, probably the hardest fight he's had to deal. So I think that's a good sign. That's a good sign that maybe there's a few more nerves there. And you're normally with nerves, you get a better performance. So you'll look to him to be keyed up and ready for this fight more so.
Of course, he's surrounded by his brothers over here as well. They're all here, the Sheffield family Hamed. It is truly incredible, really, that the story that started from that corner shop in Sheffield has come all the way to top the bill at Madison Square Garden, where Joe Lewis and Rocky Marciano, Sugar Ray Robinson, and everyone who was anyone in this sport has appeared. The lights are being dimmed. We are told that Kevin Kelly will soon make his ring entrance. Now, you may have read in the build-up to this fight that Kelly was saying that he wasn't going to hang around in the ring for 20 minutes waiting while Prince Naseem Hamed went through what Kelly described as his Saturday night fever routine and threatened not to come in first. Really, that's mandatory for him, to be perfectly honest with you. He's got to come in first as the challenger. There is Kevin Kelly. Now, he has done this all before. He's appeared loads of times at Madison Square Garden. Was almost a house fighter here. 30 years of age in his home city. Bitter that it's Naseem, the foreigner, who's earning top dollar when he, as a man who's been a world champion for a couple of years, 93 to 95, and been in a lot of big fights, he feels he should be the star attraction. Having said that, Glenn, he's earning the biggest purse of his career, kind of on the back of Naz here, isn't he?
Yes, I think he realised that it obviously hurts him that he's not the big star, as it would anybody in their own city. But he is a very intelligent, articulate, you know, he's a very good fighter, and he, you know, he has that intelligence in his head. So, you know, we've got to look to him to try and outthink Hamed. I don't think Hamed has been trying to key him up and get him to, it always seems that he's been trying to get him to have a fight with him by taunting him and telling you, you can't fight, you're not going to fight me, you're going to run. And I think Hamed wants him to come out blazing because his defenses are often a little open. And I think if Hamed sees the gap, he could well stop it very early. So Kelly's got to have a box, a very intelligent fight.
I was talking to one of the American writers and he said we won't really know about Naz until he's reached down for what he called a gut check. In other words, has he got the heart and bottle for a real tear-up, a real battle that comes down to wills and desire. This is Kelly, lost only one of 50 fights. And if you write off a man with a record like that, then, frankly, it's ridiculous. He does get hit. You can hit him, you can floor him, Kevin Kelly. But in four or five big fights, he's got off the floor to win against Goyo Vargas and Jesse Benavidez. He did it again against Derek Gaynor, the rising prospect from the Roy Jones stable. He was in terrible trouble and then just put Gaynor's lights out in the eighth round. Hard to fathom sometimes. Hard to pigeonhole style-wise. Sometimes slick and quick, stylish, other times just occasionally, he does produce a deadly punch from somewhere.
Well, he kept stressing that in the pre-fight build-up that he'd had more knockouts than Hamed had had fights. Kelly's got 32 knockouts, Hamed 28 fights. So he shows that he is a good puncher. He is very experienced, and he has seen a lot of different styles of different sorts of fighters. So he's bringing that into the ring with him.
Like Naz, he's a great self-publicist. He gives out lollipops and toffees and biscuits to his fans. Is he nervous? Doesn't really look like it, does it? I think this shapes up to be, away from home, the biggest test yet for Prince Naseem against the man who comes from the Flushing area of New York and calls himself the Flushing Flash. It's from the area where they have Flushing Meadow, the US Open tennis. He says that Naz is a media creation, an entertainer first and a fighter second. He says, I am a fighter first and an entertainer second. I'm in this business as a blue-collar champion. I do it to pay the bills, to feed my wife and four children. But is he a year or so past his best? Has he faded a little too much? Now, we await the entry of Prince Naseem Hamed, and they've rarely, if ever, seen anything like this in the United States. We're used to it back home now. What are they going to make of this? when they see this, there's a huge cheer from the American fans here and, of course, from the Brits, because I think they like a showman.
They certainly do, and they get one with Naseem Hamed. Puts on a great show, and I think this is what people have wanted to see. It's been a curiosity out here. What has he got? What is he going to bring differently? And I think he's going to show it now.
One of the newspapers here had a nice line this week. Called him the artist previously unknown as Prince. They've had to make special arrangements at Madison Square Garden with ramps and the rest to accommodate a ring walk that, by order of the American television executives, has been cut from 20, would you believe, to 10 minutes.
But meanwhile, while that's going on, Kelly, I've never seen it happen before, but Kelly and his trainer are doing some working out on the pads in the ring. So they're still very focused, concentrating on what they've got to do, looking at their game plan, and actually working on it in the ring as this is going on.
But all this is happening, remember, in a place where they've seen so many great fighters down the years. There's Kelly, who's just filling in the time. They've obviously thought about this, him and his trainer, Phil Borgia. What are we going to do for 10 minutes waiting around? Some of them, of course, wear headphones and cover their faces up, hide themselves away. But Kelly's going to stay busy and warm.
Well, it's a long... An entrance like this is a very long time to sit covered up or sit with headphones on. So I think they're doing the right thing. They're keeping warm, keeping focused, not allowing the antics of Hamed and the entrance to go against them. And they've got to keep their mind on what they're doing and just block all of this out. And they're doing it. There they go in the ring, on the pads, working, coaching, trying to keep the concentration going.
Well, he's certainly milking this for all it's worth. One or two American fans that I was speaking to earlier on said that there'll be a lot of Americans coming here tonight hoping to see Prince Naseem dumped on the seat of his pants and sent back with his tail between his legs to the other side of the Atlantic. I wonder what he's making of that. Well, he would never try anything like this, would he, Holyfield?
We'll be amazed if in his next fight he comes out and do a similar thing, won't we? He's certainly looking with interest, but it's not what Evander Holyfield's about. I think also, Ian, from another aspect, we've got to look at the danger of Naz thinking too much about what he's putting a performance on for the Americans. Because he's milking this. This is longer than a normal ring walk. He's taking an awful long time. He's got to remember it's not about dancing. He's got to try under this to keep himself focused.
Kelly is now getting very cross about this. He's up on the ring apron and getting pretty wound up and saying, OK, I've got the idea, now let's get on with this. I think he's saying this is getting a bit ridiculous.
Well, I think it's fair enough to do that. This is a fight, there is rules, and I think there should really be a time limit on an entrance. I don't think this should go on that long.
And at last, he makes his entrance. Well, it looks like something out of Hollywood, doesn't it? Never mind New York. It's the all-disco dancing entrance with somersaults still to come. But the bottom line, really, that these American fans will want to know is, can he really fight when he's pitched in at a decent level, as he is tonight?
Well, it's the big, big build-up he's given himself. Now he's got to back it up.
And of course, it's worth remembering that every time so far he has backed it up. 28 wins, 26 by knockout, 18 inside three rounds, the last 16 by stoppage. The Prince comes to the garden. A lot of the famous names of American boxing are here watching all this, among them Pernell, Sweet Pea, Whitaker. Slightly bemused look on the faces of a lot of the fans here.
Because they've never seen anything like this before. He is unique, and it is something very, very different.
And here comes the somersault. They've seen acrobatics before from the likes of Camacho and Jorge Paez over here. Prince Naseem lands in the United States.
When he landed, who was there to meet him? Kevin Kelly.
And they've been talking all week. I think they actually get on reasonably well together. They've been selling the tickets well, and looking around, it's a good crowd at Madison Square Garden. They've done a very, very good job at selling this promotion over here. They've made it into a big event. $1.75 million spent on launching Naseem in America, where they think he can become one of the really top draws. Tonight is aimed to be the start of that process, but could it all go wrong?
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Frank Warren for Sports Network, in association with Cedric Kushner Promotions, presents 12 rounds of boxing for the WBO Featherweight Championship of the World. Sponsored by Adidas, with special thanks to the Ministry of Sound in London, official suppliers of this evening's music, taken from their dance album, The Annual Three. This bout is sanctioned by the World Boxing Organization. President and supervisor at ringside, Francisco Barcasel. It is also sanctioned by the New York State Athletic Commission. Chairman, former Olympic gold medalist and two-time world heavyweight champion Floyd Patterson. Commissioners in attendance at ringside, Rose Trentman and Melville Southard. First Executive Director, Tony Russo. Executive Director, Jim Bosanello. Director of Boxing, Bob Duffy. Our physicians at ringside, Dr. Arnold Illman and Dr. Rufus Sadler. Timekeeper at the bell is Jim Borzell. The three judges scoring this bout on a 10-point must system will be Jose Rivera, Victor Salomon, and Eva Shane. And when the bell rings, the man in charge of the action, your referee, Benji Estevez. And now, for the thousands in attendance and the millions watching around the world, ladies and gentlemen, from Madison Square Garden, New York City, let's get ready to rumble! Introducing first, fighting out of the red corner, wearing green trimmed with gold and weighing 126 pounds. His professional record, an outstanding one. 47 victories, 32 by knockout with only one defeat and two draws. And he has captured two world titles. Ladies and gentlemen, from Flushing, New York, here is the WBO number 3 ranked featherweight in the world and former two-time world champion, the Flushing Flash, Kevin. His opponent, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing leopard with Adidas trim. He weighs 126 pounds also. And he also has an outstanding professional record of 28 consecutive victories in the clinch. 26 and he also has captured two world title belts. Tonight, he comes to America to show the world he must be considered as pound for pound a man of the best in the world. Ladies and gentlemen, from Sheffield, England, the leading undefeated WBO champion of the world, presenting Prince Naseem
So we're all set to go here at Madison Square Garden, which has staged some of the great featherweight fights in history. Tony Canzonieri punching out Kid Chocolate. Two of the three Willie Pep's Sandy Sadler battles. Salvador Sanchez beating Azuma Nelson, who was then an unknown, in the 15th and last round.
Okay, man.
Tough acts to follow.
Remember, protect yourself at all times. Obey my commands at all times. May the best man win. Touch up. Let's go. Come on, guys. Touch it up. All right, let's do this.
They reluctantly touch gloves for referee Benji Estevez from New Jersey. Well, this is where all the hoopla has to stop, and Prince Naseem Hamed has to show the Americans what all the fuss is about. Watch for Kelly, maybe, to try to start fast and put the pressure on straight away. Prince Naseem Hamed has been saying, I might even do this in round one, though his prediction is round three. Kelly, as you can see, southpaw, can be tricky, lots of ring craft, but can be hit and hurt as well. Hamed, who boxed beautifully in his last appearance against Jose Badillo, broke him up inside seven rounds. Usually he's quite a slow starter, Naz. Takes a look for a while. Kelly will know all about Nassim's power. And will be careful that as he tries to land these southpaw jabs and dictate the pace, that he would be open possibly for a counter from a very heavy hitter.
And in his last fight against Badillo, Hamed showed a very good southpaw jab, and I think he's got to try and get that into play. That could be difficult because he's quite widely outreached by Kevin Kelly, but he's got to get that southpaw jab working.
There's always a smile playing around the lips of Hamed, who's only been on the floor once in his career against Daniel Alicia. Good left hand from Naz there. Hamed looking as if he relishes the occasion. Bound to have been a few butterflies, I think, no matter what he might say.
There's certainly got to be. He's a good left hand.
Right hand from Kelly on the counter, and Hamed is down for the second time in his career. He left himself open, and this is trouble. He doesn't look seriously hurt, but that has got the crowd on fire here. And most of them, of course, are pro-Kelly.
Well, Hamed leapt in with a big left. That looked a good shot, but it was the quick counter from Kelly which did the damage.
This is a clever fighter, this Kevin Kelly. And he's got him again with the left hand. Make no mistake, I went to the Kelly camp very professional. They'd done their homework. They'd watched videos of Hamed over and over again to work out their strategy. Naz is not badly shaken up, though. Well, it'll be a 10-8 round-up, I think, for Kelly on the scorecards. It was not what the Prince had in mind on his American debut.
Well, that will have been a big shock for Hamed. It came out of nothing. He just leapt in as normal with his hands down.
You'll hit him with your bombs, but keep your right hand. All right.
Now take a look at this again.
Keep your right hand, okay. Right.
Yeah, he left his chin out to dry, didn't he?
He left it up in the air, hands down by his side. That's what he's got to be careful of. But in the past, fighters haven't been quick enough to capitalize on the slack defense of Hamed, but he came back very well with a quick shot, Kelly.
He was lucky in a way that Hamed was leaning away from the punch. He kind of rode it and was caught more off balance maybe than anything. If he'd been walking into that, who knows, it might have been over. Here's round two. What happens next here? We thought it would be dangerous to underestimate Kelly, and we've been proved right. But the last time he was on the floor against Alicia, Hamed came back to win in the second round. Kelly's jab, he's got it working, and he's stepping in, taking the centre of the ring, and at the moment, you'd have to say, dictating affairs. Here it is again.
Well, that sharp jab of Kelly has really got the crowd shouting in. Kelly's got the centre of the ring behind the jab, dominating at this stage.
And switching it to number attack. He's got no weapon, and he touched down again. He touched down again, and that will be another knockdown counted against Prince Naseem Hamed. He's getting caught off balance. He looks all over the place. He looks wide open, Hamed. And he gets into the right counter, and down goes Kelly on the far side. It's not counted as a knockdown. Very confusing on the far side from us. We'll take a look again at that. Just to confirm, that was not scored as a knockdown for Hamed.
Well, these fast punches from Kelly are finding massive holes, and a big right hand from Kelly there. The chin is up, the hands are down, and Hamed has to change here because he's been caught by a lot of punches from Kevin Kelly.
Well, he's picking holes in Naseem Hamed here. And you'd have to say at this moment, oh, look at that though! Look at that though! Right hand from Hamed! He's always got the power! And suddenly it's different again. There's always the hope for such a big puncher as Hamed that he'll be able to deliver a knockout blow to get himself out of trouble.
But again, Hamed, if he comes for the knockout, he has to be careful he doesn't leave his chin in the air, because Kelly's still got his wits about him.
This low-slung guard that Hamed has bases his defense on reflex. Kelly's stepping in, getting in range, and at the moment can hardly miss with the jab and with some follow-up shots as well.
Kelly is so sharp and so accurate. Normally the reflexes are very good from Hamed. He can get out of the way, make the opponent miss, but he's struggling here to make Kelly miss.
Kelly took a glance away from Hamed to somebody at ringside for a moment there. Last few seconds of the second round. Both of them have been on the floor already. Well, it's extraordinary what has happened here in this fight already. And, well, in the past, we have wondered about Hamed's defense, this lunging, and Kelly has got the technical answers, hasn't he?
He really has the fast hands, finding massive gaps in the defense. Well, the defense of Hamed is always just reflexes, and it's not working tonight. Look at that. Have you ever seen him get hit like that before? The chin up, but there, just a short little right hand. He came back with that well. He wasn't seriously hurt, Kelly. Give him a little look, almost just to say, well done, you got me there. What an unbelievable round this is.
And then he took another one for good measure there as Kelly went down in the corner. That was not counted as a knockdown. Here's the third round. Again, the southpaw jab from Kelly, the native New Yorker. And his fans here are really believing that they can rip up the pre-fight script.
And they've obviously came here with a very good game plan, the Kelly crew. And they're shouting in the corner, use the reach.
Oh, he put him with the left hand, and he did a bit of a silly dance with the legs there, Hamed. Here, Hamed is fighting a man who really believes that he has the tools to beat Hamed. He's going in with real self-belief.
That jab is such a good weapon from Kelly, so very, very sharp.
And Hamed isn't slipping it at all. Well, can he find some answers here? This is a man who has said he just cannot be beaten, that he'll be a legend.
And again, a big left hand from Kelly. Hamed just cannot get out of the way of these punches.
It's an unpalatable truth, but at the moment, Hamed is being outboxed. No question about it. This jab is just knocking his head back. And the entire American enterprise could be grounded unless maybe Prince Naseem can just detonate one of his really big punches to turn the whole thing on its head. Well, we never thought we'd see this, I don't think, did we, Glenn?
I don't think so. I think we knew that Kelly had very good capabilities and he had to box an intelligent fight, and he's shown that. He's obviously went to school, locked himself away, he's studied how he's got to beat Hamed, and at the moment he's going through with his game plan very well indeed.
Whatever they worked on, and you can see it here, is working, although there's a right hand from Hamed. And a very good little short left hand too from Hamed. That was better. Now he's starting to get through. Can he work his way back? Kelly again glancing at somebody off stage and not in his corner either.
5 seconds.
Last few seconds of round three, and that was a Kelly round again. That was the round that Naseem predicted he would win the fight. We're past that.
If you don't move your head, we're going to run into difficulties, and I don't want that. What we worked on to get this guy out of here was our tempo, correct? When you're hunting a peanut, think what you did to Craig. Think what you did to Frank.
And watching at ringside, Ryan Rhodes, who lost in his world title attempt last week against Otis Grant in Sheffield, and he must be worried. The aura of invincibility that surrounded the camp is suddenly looking punctured.
Pick them off, you will gradually break them up off your jab.
Yeah.
There's a bing, bing. Bang, then come back. Come break them up on. He's had his fun now, he's had his fun. You start giving
the words of Brendan Ingle, whose brother, by the way, a leading Irish amateur, fought in this arena about 60 years ago. Here's round four.
The third again was a Kelly round, with Hamed coming back into it just towards the end, but not quite doing enough to win the round.
Hamed has to start bringing his own jab into play. But Kelly has a 5-inch reach advantage, and part of their plan was to use that. And now he's slipping a few more punches.
I think if Kelly starts coming closer to Hamed, that will suit Hamed more. Kelly's boxed so well from long range, using his reach and his speed. He doesn't want to get lulled into a fight, but the fight will suit Hamed.
Just wonder whether Naseem has frozen a little early on his American debut as well. Think that's part of it?
It could well be a point. He's not getting his boxer together. He doesn't seem to have his speed. His reflexes are very poor. But I think we've got to say, at this point, it's a very good performance from Kevin Kelly. He's doing everything right.
And they're just starting to pick up the tempo. And he's got him down. Hamed could turn this all around yet. That was a heavier shot. Kelly says he's all right, but he's down for the second time, and maybe this is the breakthrough after some very anxious, not to say embarrassing, moments for Hamed early on.
But Kelly had to keep it long range, as I said. He's getting involved in a fight. He's closing down, getting close to Hamed, and this is where Hamed can get him with punches.
It's another count. He touched down again. Touched down with a glove. It was a right hand. To take another count. He's not badly hurt, but he keeps touching down because he's off balance with the gloves. Big right, Hamed. And another hook. It might not be the end of it. No. Kelly bounces up. The count is at six. He's down for the second time in the round. Is he going to make it? No, he doesn't. He's knocked out. It is over. And Prince Naseem Hamed. Well, the American dream does take off for him after it looked so dodgy for so long. What an amazing fight that was.
An amazing fight, but he prevailed with the extra power. Kelly decided to get in a fight, took the fight to him. As soon as he did that, Hamed, with his extra power, it then became his sort of fight, and he could take over. And the power was the key for Hamed. But from long range, Kelly was doing everything right. And I just do not know why he changed tactics and decided that now was the time to step in and take the fight to Hamed.
Well, I tell you what, everybody connected with the American TV companies, Frank Warren, everybody must be breathing a huge, huge sigh of relief. And there was a little question about whether Kelly had got up before it got quite to 10. I think he probably just didn't quite make it. The referee was right on top of it. But there were some anxious moments there.
Very, very anxious. I don't think he'd want to be in a fight like that again, Hamed. And I think he's got to look at his defense a little. Tremendous that he could pull it out and win when it was all going so badly, when he'd been on the floor, when he'd been hurt, but yet he could still pull it out. But he's just got to, he's got to look at that fight long and hard at the mistakes he made, and there were many.
He's won, but really, it has to be said, not in the way that they would have hoped for.
There's the big left hand. Kelly goes down very heavily. But now it was Hamed's game. Kelly was too close to him, wasn't behind that long reach, and Hamed could then start to take over. There's just where Hamed had to take a count, caught by a punch, leaping in, and he touched down with his right hand.
Absolutely extraordinary. It was the extra power of Naseem Hamed that won him that fight in the end. But I don't think really anybody could have pre-scripted or pre-choreographed what we saw there.
There the power comes into play, that short, choppy little left hand. A good punch. There it is again. The legs just turn to jelly.
And the punch power maybe, well, almost definitely got Prince Naseem out of jail there.
It really did. I think credit to Hamed for showing good character, for not falling apart under pressure when everything was going so wrong. He kept at it and finally come out a winner.
Official time, 2 minutes, 27 seconds of round number four. Referee Benji Estevez calls a halt to the bout. The winner and still the undefeated WBA featherweight champion of the world, Prince Naseem Hamed.
Well, he's still the champion. It was his ninth defense of the title. But he was on the floor three times, three counts against him, three against Kelly, but the extra power of Hamed has won him victory in his first appearance in America. Now, it'll be interesting to hear what Naseem Hamed has to say about that. Larry Merchant is in there with his microphone, and I wonder what they're going to say about the events of the first couple of rounds. But maybe there, Kelly gave a little message to other future opponents of Naseem Hamed about ways of tackling him. What it did show was that there is still a lot to work on.
Yes, there is. I think a fighter would always bring that about, that the defense has to get better. You can't rely on the reflexes all the time, which was proven there. Kelly had longer arms, was faster, and was catching him time and time again. And I think he's got to look at a plan B when it needs it. He's got the power. It was a tremendous performance and a tremendous fight to do it.
What happened in this fight tonight?
Well, first of all, I come out of the first round, and I know my jab was too clean and nice and fast, but still, I wanted a bit of a fight. I wanted to cause so much excitement in this arena. It's my first night. It's my first fight in New York, Madison Square Garden, and I wanted to show the people here that I can fight. I can take it on the chin, and I can give it. End of the day, he caught me some great shots. All due respect to Kevin, but I wanted to basically take him out, and I just wanted to show all my skill on the night. I wanted to make it look exciting for everybody, so I had to take some shots, but I give my shots. Now, I took his, but did he take mine?
Well, we're going to watch round one and the knockdown in round one when you were knocked down.
My hair looked good.
Were you stunned by what was going on here? Was he presenting a different picture than you imagined?
I didn't really see the shot, so I've got to give it him. But look at me, straight up. That's the heart of a lion. That is a heart of a lion.
Right.
A champion's heart, straight up. Compose myself, get back. Even though I got hit with some good shots, I came back and I gave him my shots. And he didn't take my shot.
No. You fought in what appeared to be a more orthodox fashion than you have in other fights. Explain why.
Because I was here, it was my first time at Madison Square Garden. I wanted to cause some exciting. I wanted a fight. I know I can fight. I know when it comes down to it, when it comes down to heart and of a heart of a champion and getting in there and taking the fight, whatever you've got to take, you've got to give. And I give mine and he gave his and he couldn't take it. I knew.
When did you sense that he was weakening and that he couldn't really take your power?
Well, I started getting closer and closer. I started getting closer and closer. I knew once I hit him, now he went down before I took him out, and the referee looked in his eyes and he couldn't take any of it. He couldn't take no more. If the referee let me at him again, it'd have been the best.
All right, here's
look,
there's
look at that. There you go. There you go. Now, if I didn't walk up to him too as fast as I did,
he wouldn't get up. That was in the second round.
There you go. All I hit him with a perfect right hand. Now look, you can see him smiling, but he knows the pain. I was smiling when he hit me. I was smiling, but end of the day, my feet was back together, my head was clear. I got up straight away, composed myself, and took him out.
It seemed that both of you both liked and respected each other.
Definitely. Kevin is a very, very nice guy. I get on with Kevin, I got on with Tom Johnson, all the American fighters, the great guys in and out the ring. So end of the day, I just want to fight. And I did that, and I took him out. I came to America. I proved myself. I'm 29-0. What can I say? The last time, they've all gone knockouts now from 94. I've stopped every one of them from 94.
Repeat what you said to Kevin at the end of the fight.
Kevin, you're probably one of the best I've boxed, if not the best. I know I'm the best you've boxed, and he said that to me and all. And we've got great respect for each other, but end of the day, I am the world champion. And people got to realize I am the champion of the world.
Thank you very much, Prince, Jim, George.
All right.
Well, he's still world champion, isn't he? But we're going to debate for some time how exactly he got through that. We knew it was going to be explosive. Kevin Kelly, a proven puncher himself, of course, with 32 knockout victories before tonight. But I don't think anybody expected it to be quite so dramatic, swinging one way and the other. And somehow Naseem, the younger man, prevailed. Looks like Ian Dark's fighting his way into the ring, but there's another embrace between these two. They've been shouting at each other all week. Just goes to show you, really, it's all just showmanship. And it produced a big crowd at Madison Square Garden and a big buzz in there. One wonders how this will play across America. Have they been impressed by his punch power? Here's Ian.
Yes, here is Prince Naseem Hamed now. Naz, if I could just have a quick word. The power did it for you in the end.
Definitely, you saw my power and you saw his power. Now he caught me with some great, great shots, but I caught him with great shots. I took all his best shots and I gave mine and he couldn't take mine. Nah, I just wanted to fight. I didn't care about my boxing skills, I didn't care about anything. I just wanted excitement. I'm here in Madison Square Garden in the Mecca of boxing this day, and it was exciting, believe me, for me and the crowd.
Was that the American debut that you had in mind?
To tell you the truth, I didn't think I'd have got caught nowhere near as much. But end of the day, I wanted a fight. I wanted a fight, and it came out of me. I took what I had to take. You've seen the heart of a champion. I'm returning with my belt all the way back to England, back to Sheffield. Respect to Leash, I'm coming home now, that's it. I'm the best, and I know I'm the best.
Tell us the truth here. Were you a little bit nervous? Did you freeze a bit before? Because he was catching you like you'd not been caught before with those southpaw jabs early, wasn't he?
He caught me, but I ain't boxed that many southpaws. But I've got to give him all respect to him. He caught me with some very, very good shots. But no, I wasn't all stiff and all that. I just wanted to fight. I didn't box the way I wanted to box. But end of the day, when I come out there, I just wanted a pure fight. And I wanted to win by knocking somebody out that much. And I took him out. I took his power and he couldn't take mine. That's all I'm saying.
Is there a bit of relief that you're still the champion after all that?
No relief at all. I knew I was going to win. I knew once I hit him properly, I was going to take him out. And I did so. Returning back to Sheffield with my nice belt, as I always got. I come back to America, beat the whole rest of them. I beat one, knocked him out. I'm coming home.
I'll tell you something. After being in a great fight like that, they'll have you back here in double quick time.
Definitely. I told you, they've seen the excitement themselves. I took some great shots. That he did, and he couldn't take mine, and I took his. Always remember that, the heart of a champion, the heart of a lion. And you know, at the end of it, God is on my side.
Yeah, it was a great power that won the fight. Frank Warren, let's bring you in here. Frank, what did you make of that? I bet your heart was in your mouth, wasn't it, times?
They were just so excited. It was exciting. I knew he'd get to him at the end, but all defense went out the window. I mean, you know, he wasn't throwing his jabs. He was getting caught, and he was just looking to take him out. He came here, he said, I'm going to really create some excitement. The ring walk took much longer than normal. He was stuck behind that screen. I don't know what happened there. And, you know,
I think it was a bit cold early on, wasn't he, there?
Yeah, they left him behind. I don't know what happened. So anyway, that's a problem, and we saw that. But as far as the fight's concerned, it was just an excellent fight. It was exciting. The crowd loved it. And, you know, he proved it. He gets hit on the chin, he gets caught, but he gets up. That's what champions do. They get up when they get caught. And he managed to do that. And the difference was he could take his shots. Kevin couldn't take Naz's.
He's a relieved man, Frank Warren. What happens now, Frank? Are we going to see him in Britain again soon, or will it be here next?
We're going to come back in March. We're going to fight in March. Or that Naz is going to fight in March, and that will probably be in Britain. We're not leaving Britain for America. It's important what we've done here, and we'll be back here again in the future. But, you know, where we need to be is England.
As an introduction, it was much better in winning like that than in a boring 12-round points lockout.
You have never seen him in a boring fight. That's why people come. You know, he takes chances. He puts pressure on himself. He takes risks. That's the way he fights. That's why the crowd buy tickets. That's why they come to see him fight. You never know what's going to happen in a fight. You know, he lives on the edge. He fights on the edge. And sometimes he throws caution to the wind. And it's, you know, for me, I hate to see it, but he does it. And then the next fight, he'll box brilliantly. And that's what makes him, that's why he's such an exciting fighter, that's why he's box office.
All right, thanks a lot, Frank. Cheers.
That's what he is, a risk taker. Maybe over time the flaws will be exposed, but I'll tell you what, it's a fabulous roller coaster ride for the rest of us while we find out. Naseem Hamed retains his WBO World Featherweight title on a night of surprises, the biggest surprise of all, nearly being knocked out by Kevin Kelly early on. Somehow he prevailed. And it was a thriller. Thoughts of Barry McGuigan, Nicky Piper, Duke McKenzie and Steve Collins when we come back from this. We've all had a lot of food for thought there at Madison Square Garden tonight. Hello there again, Naseem's name will be up in lights all across New York. He's still a world champion, but how close he came to throwing it all away against Kevin Kelly. The former world champion gave it everything. Let's hear from Kelly. He's talking to Larry Merchant.
I could hurt him when I hit him. I hit harder than he did, and I felt his power. It wasn't as big as he said it was. It wasn't bigger than everybody thinks it is. And I showed him mine. And when I showed him mine, I hurt him. And the difference was, I blame myself for getting over-anxious and becoming acceptable to get hit by him.
When you hit a guy that hard and you knock him down, there's a tendency to believe you can do it again and want to get rid of him, right?
I did it many times, and that's what happened. I kept doing it. I continued to do it. But the problem was, I wanted to keep him there. And because I wasn't keeping him there, I started getting over-anxious, and that's when I got caught with the first punch that knocked me down. It was more of a flash knockdown. But like I said, I get up and I continue.
All right, let's take a look at what happened in round one, your knockdown of him.
Right here, I'm setting him up. He's getting over anxious. I noticed when I hit him with the first punch, I said, man, every time I hit him, I hurt him. Everybody says about crystal chins, one thing about him, I showed tonight, he's not as good as he says he is. He's a good fighter. I give him most of respect. He's champion tonight. He came on top. The only reason I'm not champion tonight, I want to let everybody know, no fear, who endorsed me, and EA, or sports game, which I'm coming out on, the reason I lost tonight, because I deviated from my training thoughts.
Well, but then he gets credit for making you deviate, doesn't he?
No, I deviated because of me. I'm the kind of fighter that Phil always tells me, my wife always tells me, my father tells me, I'm my worst enemy.
All right, let's turn to the end of the fight and your memory of what happened. If we can get there, you have suffered one previous knockdown in this round.
Well, here, I'm trying to set him up with the jab. He's very careless. He does a lot of mistakes. Hit me with overhand left. As you can see, I'm down, but I'm not really that hurt. I'm going to stay down a little wobbly, but just like, okay, cool. I'm understandable. I'm going to get up to count of eight. I got up to count of eight, take the rest. You see me, I'm a veteran at this. I know what it is to get knocked down. I figure I'll take the full rest. Phil's telling me grab him. I'm looking at the corner. I want to come back. Because what happens is, when he starts loading and throwing, he starts getting over-anxious himself, and he was getting caught.
But you have to give him credit for his power. He came into you. He came into your building, and he took care of business.
He came in my building, but one thing, like he said, I'm the best fighter he's ever fought, never will fight. The bottom line is that...
Let's see if we get the rematch.
I can do it again down the road somewhere. Right now...
Kevin, you were just a part... Of the Hagler Hearns of the featherweight division, you have nothing to be ashamed of.
Well, I started this. I'm happy. I'm content. My wife's content with everything that's went on. She's a little angry at, what has happened in this whole event. But, Kevin Kelly came. He showed that Ahmed is not the fighter everybody says he is, not the Roy Jones.
Still has a black belt in verbal karate, even though he's been knocked out by Naseem Hamed. Let's get some initial reactions from here. Barry first.
First of all, that was a magnificent performance by Naz. He lives by the sword. He will eventually bite the dust. And he almost did tonight. He's not the star that HBO... what he said there at the end, he's not the star that HBO thought they were buying into. Well, I tell you what, he can fight, and he is so exciting. But, I have to say... He really shouldn't fight so dangerously. He's such a temerity and audacity. He's gonna bite the bullet one of these days.
He has prevailed again, though, Nicky, hasn't he?
He is, and I think he is the star that HBO thought they were buying into. I think he's brilliant box office, and I think he suffered from the ring entrance. We said at the time there's something going wrong there. He was getting annoyed and frustrated behind that screen. He wanted to come out.
He has no doubt about that.
That affected his concentration more, I think, than it affected Kelly's. And then I think, as I said, I think he was suffering a bit of pressure and concentration.
Duke.
Yeah, for pure excitement and adrenaline and all the rest of it, the fight was just. we was all in the seat of our pants. But I've got to say that. I feel that that would have damaged his markability and his credit,
No doubt about that. He was hard to knock down a few times, and he looked like on the brink of disaster a few times.
The punch as well from a big
hang on. Steve, of all of us, Steve has actually worked longer in America probably than the rest of us put together. What's your view on how it'll be received?
Well, it's his first fight in the States, and Americans have a style which is not fair. I'd always fought Americans in Britain. Maybe they were under pressure. They didn't perform as well as he could, but fighting Americans in their own backyard... With a style that, he was caught with a lot of wide hooks tonight. He was caught too often. And he was hurt. He got up, he showed great heart, and he has great power. That's why he won the fight. But he was caught a little too often for my liking. Naseem is 23, Kelly's 30. I wonder if, where will Naseem be when he's 30 if he keeps getting caught like that,
Let's go through it round by round here, Barry. What a start.
Yeah, that was an amazing first. And watch the way he gets hit here. We'll show from a couple of different angles. He gets hit. Now, that is a full-blooded right hook he got nailed on the chin. And if you see it from an overhead shot, watch, he comes right up, lifts his chin up, and he took that. He got knocked down, he got back up again, he took it. Now, I'm not running the guy down, I'm just saying he lives too dangerously. He hit him with an unmerciful shot. He would have thought at that stage he'd have gathered himself, got his hands up, and started moving around to clear his head. What did he do? He comes slamming right back in again. Exactly the same thing. And round two, again, he was hit. And look at now, that shot there wouldn't have knocked out any featherweight. Knocked him right, snapped his head right
back.
Let's
hope he learns from this, Barry.
Yeah, well, I don't think he will, Nicky. That's the thing I'm talking about. He's got such nerves. Yeah. You know, he says, I'll never change like Ryan Rhodes and like all of Brendan's fighters. He says, well, that was a great shot he hit Kevin Kelly with. A straight shot, he hit him right on the button. And, you know, handed to Kelly too. He got up as well. And as Stevie says, he's 30 years old. He's no spring chicken. And he got up off the floor and he showed that he has got the heart of a fighter too and a heart of a lion and came back. But, you know, it was just absolutely fantastic. We were sitting there screaming our heads off.
And we go to round three, Nicky. Mm-hmm. Was this a fight that could go either way in round three?
Oh, certainly. But right now, Stanley came back on top and Kelly... He was getting caught there, of course, but we were saying, Barry, you were saying that Kelly started to look a little jaded or losing his concentration and his momentum. And now started to box a bit better, started to use the jab a little more and landed the punches, the finisher. But for Kelly to say that his punches weren't that hard...
Oh, no, but that was ridiculous. We were looking at him lying prostrate in the fourth round there and he was saying... I was just taking a few seconds. He was saying, will I get up or won't I? But he did get up and, I mean, this was the end. This is the fourth round. He hits to the first knockdown. He knocks him down. And at that size, look at the way he fell on his arm.
Didn't think he was going to get up.
I thought, well, he's never going to get up at that stage. But he really did show tremendous courage. He got up. And then look what he does. He hits Naz with a shot. And I thought that this was ridiculous of the referee to administer an 8-count at that stage. It was what we said at the time, Nicky, if you remember, was he was just giving him a temporary respite.
Yes,
And again, this was the shot that ended matters, really. His head, he went down, he says, I was just thinking to myself, will I get back?
And he's totting up at 9.5, you know. Exactly.
Some people may watch this, Duke, and say, here's a case of a younger puncher beating an older puncher.
Yeah, it certainly looked like that.
And it's that simple? That
it was the case. You had a young guy and a young, fresh guy beating an older guy and that could both punch. And
yeah, but 30's not too old.
Yeah, but fortunately for Hamid, his recuperative powers were far greater than Kelly.
Absolutely, yes. If he hadn't been,
he would have been in big trouble.
Well, it is down to you. You are as old as the amount of punches you take.
50 fights and you're fighting a featherweight. 30's all the featherweight. 50 fights ages you.
You are as old as the amount of punches you take. But the one thing we wanted to dwell on here was his reputation damaged by that. Now, you can tell me that it wasn't.
I wonder what Steve thinks about that. How will the American TV companies who've invested so much in Naseem view that performance?
Well, I'm sure they were nervous when he got caught, but what I will say is they paid to see excitement, and they did see excitement.
Exactly. Oh, yeah. They'd be worried.
I'm obviously a fan of Naseem. I just, when he gets hit, I don't like to see him get hit because I want to see him hitting and not being hit.
But Stevie,
when he got caught, you know, I never seen him get cut so often before. And what it'll do is it'll teach him a lesson, and I think it'll make him a better fighter because I think his defense will be better because he realizes, although he is a great champion, he's still human and he still can be cut. So I think it actually will improve him. It was a very good learning lesson, and he showed he has a good chin. He's taken his shots. He came back and he's got the power to knock anybody out. Although he got hurt, or not hurt, he got cut. He'll argue with me, but I'm going to say hurt. Although he got cut, I think it will improve him. It was an education he got tonight, and it'll make him a better fighter. But I just don't like to see him get cut so often in three or four rounds.
Thank you, Steve. Just before we close, here we mentioned the competition tonight, Naseem's autographed gloves. This is the question we asked. Tonight, Naseem making the 9th defence of his world featherweight title against Kelly. Who is his first opponent in a world title defence? And the answer, we showed you the action, but we left the commentary out. Saeed Lawal was the man from Nigeria. It was March 1996, just over 18 months ago. Naseem winning on a first round stoppage. And well done to Paul Bedwell from Ipswich. The autographed gloves are on the way to you, Paul. Hope they find a good home with you. Right, well, Steve has told us how he views the American reception to that performance by Naseem. Other thoughts, maybe, from you, Barry, about where Naseem is going in the future.
Yeah, well, I understood from the HBO deal that he was going to fight over there on a more regular basis, and I assumed that he would be fighting in his next fight over there too. I'm glad he's coming back here because he keeps us all in work, and I'm delighted. I'm delighted that he got through. We were all sitting there with our hearts in our mouths. We're delighted he's won. He's a super kid, and I don't want it to be in any way negative to him. I just wish he wouldn't live so dangerously. I'd like to see him have an easier fight now to come back and just to regain his confidence again, and then maybe go out and tackle America again. But, you know, he's talked about fighting legends and he's talked about fighting champions, so it's going to happen pretty soon that he fights somebody in another weight division.
Thank you, Barry. And one closing thought from Duke and from Nicky. I'll ask you both. Has he got to get a defence from somewhere?
I think so. I think the problem tonight was he was trying to lean out of the way of the punches and leaning onto them, whereas maybe as good Americans do, they lean into a punch, they lean inside the punch and let the punch go around the back of the head.
And thank you, and Duke.
Easy fight's not in Hamid's makeup. You know, he's not going to get out there and take an easy fight, and as far as leaning back goes, that is his natural style.
He's not
he likes
change.
To get out of the way
well,
of punch.
Try.
He likes to live on the edge, and living like that is, you know, it might have the chemistry, the wrong sort of chemistry, you know, to plummet.
Time for us to go. Thanks very much to Barry, Nicky, Duke and Steve Collins. Most of all, thank you very much for staying with us right through the night. I hope we've entertained you. We think we have. London Arena was pretty good, but events at Madison Square Garden tonight almost defy belief. He lives on the edge, but it's a great place to be, and he's still a champion. Bye for now.